Hello and welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent guest for you, but before I go ahead, make sure you subscribe to the channel and share this amazing content with your communities in healthcare. And let me also acknowledge our partners. As a content partner, we have FUJIFILM Healthcare. The series partner, we have Salesforce, the world's number one CRM for healthcare and life sciences. And we have Spirit Digital, our global partner. But without further ado, I'm very excited and very enthusiastic to have a fantastic guest for you today. We have Dr. G. She is the SVP and Executive Medical Director at Salesforce. Dr. G, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks so much for having me on, João. I'm so excited that your name is so much cooler than mine. I love saying it, João. All right, I'm not sure I got it right.
You are so kind. We were talking before the recording about I've been following you for such a long time, and the work that you do is incredible, and you're engaging and making serious impact along and amongst the healthcare professionals. So well done.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And you as well. There's a lot of work to be done. I think it's taking all of us. That's for sure.
Sure. We push through together. I'm going to start with the questions. Are you okay with that?
Absolutely. Go for it.
Brilliant. So the first question that I have for you is, how can data be best used and leveraged by patients and healthcare professionals?
Sure. So it's a great question. And certainly with COVID, we're certainly seeing that data is king. So I think in a couple of ways, as we think about using data for patients, I think it's number one, it's important that we are getting them their own information, their own data. We then have to help them interpret that data, right? So it's one thing to get your medical records, but what does it mean when your hematocrit is low? What does it mean when your platelets are high? This is the whole practice of medicine. And I think that we've kind of blurred those lines. So I think it's important that we also help educate patients as much as we can do this in real time, right? That's the magic, is being able to get a result and then be able to essentially action or engage the patient to say, based on this, we want you to come in, or based on this, let's set up a telemedicine visit, or based on this, let's get a mammogram, a colonoscopy, et cetera. So I think there's a kind of next best action piece to this. Certainly AI technologies come into this. And this is really just practicing medicine again in real time or retrospectively. I think the real future of data, and certainly where there's a lot of promise, is on the physician side, which is for clinical decision support, right? Being able to support physicians, you know, actioning and actioning up data in real time on based on X, Y, and Z, this is a possible treatment plan. And of course, it's up to them, the doc, to interpret that. And as well as predictive analytics, right? Being able to, based on the data, then understand, hey doc, you know, this patient looks like they're at risk for ending up in the emergency room. It's time to bring them in, or it's time to do this lab work based on their history, based on certain standards and guidelines. So I think that's kind of the spectrum of where data can serve both the patient as well as the doctor. But we have a lot of work to do before we certainly get there.
Oh, brilliant, fantastic. And you mentioned a couple of things, data being simplified in a different way as information to serve the professionals and the patients. And as you know, I've been involved in many global events around the world, and this conversation around data is going on for many, many years. But I think now we're entering a different phase where we can actually have data and starting to know what to do with it. So yeah, brilliant. Thank you so much for those insights. I'm going to move on to the second question. And the second question is, what are the most common challenges encountered around health and medical data?
Sure. I mean, gosh, we don't have enough time to discuss that, right? On the patient side, it's certainly access to data, access to accurate data, just like we talked about interpretation of that data, even if you get it, right? Interoperability continues to be a challenge in the industry. If you went to hospital A versus hospital B, Dr. A versus Dr. B, increasingly retail now, again, so many folks are getting their vaccines, CVS, Walgreens, none of that data is connected, right? So one, just getting access to the data, but then again, all the downstream pieces to that, which is the interpretation of it, the prediction of it, but increasingly this is going to, I think we're going to see this even more in the industry, especially as we see the retailization of healthcare. So therein lies the opportunity, right? Is to ensure that we actually get access to the data, we have interoperability standards, and that we are doing all the things we just talked about in the first question, which is making it valuable both for the patient as well as for the doc. I will also comment in the environment that we're in, that's patient data, right? HPI. But as we think about misinformation, disinformation, there's a lot of information that affects how patients think about their healthcare. And there's an opportunity there to really connect the patient and the doctor, ensure that patient education data is accurate, is meaningful, and is relevant to an individual as well as to a population. So again, much work to be done.
Oh, sure. Thank you so much for that. And it seems to be a global issue about the disconnect around the data and the systems and the interoperability. You know, I'm based in UK, we were talking about that before. It's the same problem in here. If you go to an hospital in the north of the country and then you go, for example, in London, the systems are not together because they have different vendors and different systems. So it seems to be a global issue across the board. Moving on to the third and last question. What is the most important role of technology that can play in order to support the healthcare professionals to focus on seeing patients more time?
Sure. So our product teams at Salesforce hear me say this all the time. The best health technology for a doctor, for a nurse, for the care team is an invisible technology, right? We docs, we nurses, we just want to see patients. That's what we went to medical school for, as we went to nursing school for. That's what we enjoy is patient care. The administrative side increasingly needs to be more invisible, i.e. more intuitive, i.e. more convenient workflows that make sense, right? And meaningful, right? Not just kind of a checkbox as far as regulations and reimbursement. So again, much work to be due on the clinical side. On the patient side, I think it is all about convenience, right? Bringing the healthcare industry the way that the hospitality industry has been transformed, the banking industry, right? Increasingly, that digital transformation and convenience in the home, mobily, those virtual visits, care from anywhere, you know, is our mantra here at Salesforce. And we want to really ensure that we're meeting the patients where they are. And we've experienced that through the pandemic, which is at home or on the go or in their community. And I think when you make healthcare convenient, patients take advantage of it, right? If there are 6 months of a waiting time to see a primary care doctor, you're not going to see a primary care doctor. It's very simple. Or you're going to have an outcome that could have been mitigated by increasing that access. And by having those digital extenders, it truly, truly gets to the patient, as well as this convenience factor that I think we've all appreciated during the pandemic. And I think will continue to evolve, particularly as we see the retailization of healthcare, where folks are getting their vaccine at a CVS or a Walgreens and then picking up their milk and eggs as they're walking out the door. So there's, again, much work to be done, but we've made tremendous strides as an industry, and I think we will continue to.
Well, fantastic. Thank you so much for those insights. And yeah, we can learn from other industries. And I really see that the pandemic really highlighted the things that we should be doing or could do better in terms of the virtual care and care at home and in different settings. And you guys doing great work in that regard. Well, Dr. G, has been fantastic. The three questions just flew by very quickly. And on the other hand, we could have spent maybe an hour on each, right? It's so much.
That's right.
It's so much to talk about, but I'm going to wrap up and finish the episode. But before that, I finish all my episodes in this peculiar way. It's not really a question as such. It's called 1 minute of fame. Okay. So over to you. You can talk about anything else, professional achievements, your personal life. I mean, about Salesforce, about client, anything whatsoever. Over to you to wrap up 1 minute of fame.
So sorry, you want me to just talk for a minute, like a message to the audience?
Yeah, you can send a message. You can highlight anything in your professional or personal life, anything whatsoever. So over to you.
Sure. So, you know, my message to your audience is, number one, those of us that are in the health tech industry, the healthcare industry, I would just say that keep going, right? It's been a tough 18 months. I think we're continuing to see cautious optimism as the end of the year approaches and we think about where we are in the pandemic. So I would, one, just say that take this time to feel really good about the role you play in healthcare. Take it seriously. You are moving the industry forward. We need you. Keep going. Thinking outside the box, you know, the inside out mentality is really what we need. Those who understand healthcare but are able to look around, see what's out there, and think very differently. I think this is the time for innovation. Digital transformation is going to be part of the way that we get out of this pandemic. And secondly, for those that are still on the fence about getting the vaccine, it is time. It is time to get vaccinated. It is really time. If you continue to have questions or concerns about you or your family's decision and have not gotten vaccinated, please make an appointment with your doctor. And if you don't have a doctor, certainly go online, try to get one via telemedicine or talk to your pharmacist. But really, we need to move forward as a community, and we need to help each other. And I appreciate that these are really confusing times. Information is not clear. So go to your doc, go to your pharmacist, get those questions asked. And I hope that you will choose to get vaccinated the same as me and my family, and that we can all meet together in person and do this interview next year in 2022, João. So thank you. Thank you again for the opportunity.
Fantastic. What a great way to finish. A fantastic, strong message for the healthcare community, but also for humanity as overall. Humanity, I mean, as a community, because we all need to, I mean, push forward together. I want to thank you for your time, for your expertise, and your amazing insights. Thank you so much.
Thanks, João. Take care. Be well.
Thank you. So to our viewers and listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel. I'm going to post all the links to connect with Dr. G. Follow her on Twitter, on LinkedIn, the great work that she's doing. Check out Salesforce, and I'll see you all next week.